This question is about micromanaging versus self-organization in our yoga teaching and in our yoga poses. I am a bit puzzled about your point about self-organization versus micromanaging. As from my own experience, adding a more subtle second or third, etc., layer of instructions is where a pose starts to unfold its potential magic. So isn't that a really good question? I thought that we would really like this question. So this is referring to the foundational concepts video that I shared this week. And this is foundational concepts for analyzing and understanding movement. And in that video, I talked about my personal approach to alignment and teaching alignment in yoga. And I talked about how I use alignment. I think alignment is an essential tool in our yoga teaching and in our yoga practice. But I prefer to use alignment in a bigger picture sense to guide my students' bodies into the general shape of the yoga poses that I'm teaching in the moment. But I don't use alignment in what I would call a micromanaging sense, which is like micromanaging all the way down to these fine-tuned details, exactly how our students' bodies must be positioned, and that like everyone should be positioned the same way, and that there's like this long line of check boxes that everybody must check off with all the alignment of their joints down to the finest detail. So that's kind of what I'm talking about. And when I say micromanaging, the term micromanaging, here's what the definition of micromanaging is. It's to control every part, however small, of an activity or enterprise. So hopefully you can see how I'm suggesting that there's a difference between teaching yoga poses from a general, like bigger picture approach. I'm gonna offer general big picture cues to guide my students into the pose that I'm teaching. But then once they're there, when it comes down to these like fine tuned, like however small details, I don't worry about controlling those details and telling students exactly how they must position their body, like as though those tiny check boxes that they must check off are the one right way to be in the pose, and I'm telling them exactly what to do. So there's a difference though when it comes to like what we might call like the detailed levels of our yoga poses, or the more subtle fine-tuned levels of our yoga poses, like what I think Francisca's referring to in her question. There's a difference between controlling that stuff and micromanaging that stuff and correcting alignment to like check these boxes. There's a difference between controlling it and using the details and the fine-tuned ways of feeling and being in a pose and the subtle elements of the pose. There's a difference between using those as tools to explore and experience the pose, using like fine details in a yoga pose as more of a tool for self-inquiry, self-knowledge, learning about our own body, feeling our body in these poses. So that's kind of what this comes down to. I actually really think that Francisca and I would totally agree. I actually think that the subtle level is where so much of the magic can happen in our yoga poses. But I just think that as a yoga teacher, it's more productive to use the subtle level as more of like an invitation, exploration, like guiding students to feel and explore their own bodies versus using the detailed level to direct and guide students and tell them exactly how they must arrange and align their bodies. So hopefully you can kind of see, hopefully that's becoming a little clear about that difference between, yes, details are important and the subtle level is important, but it's more about how we use it. Are we being controlling and micromanaging and correcting people? Or are we using an awareness of the subtle levels of our poses to guide students to just feel their own bodies and through that to self-organize their poses in those more detailed points of alignment? So let's look at an example of, say, plank pose. When it comes to plank, if I'm teaching plank, I typically offer some kind of general bigger picture cues. I might say, place your hands shoulder distance apart. I do pretty much want them to be I don't want them to be like this. Not that this is bad, but it's probably not what I'm teaching in the moment. And I don't want their hands to be like this. I pretty much want them to be under their shoulders. But do I need to get super detailed about it? Do I need to ask my students to look down at your arms, find the center of your wrist crease, and make that bisect the center of your shoulder so that there's an exact vertical line from the center of your shoulder down through the center of the wrist crease? So find that. And if you're like 1 degree wider of that or 1 degree narrower, that's like wrong and you need to correct that. Like that would be an example to me of micromanaging. And that's not how I would personally teach plank pose. I find it to be more productive to invite students to like kind of find their own pose, but within the parameters, within the box of the yoga pose that I'm teaching. So to me, I might ask students, like if I wanted to get into hand distance, hand width, I might say, place your hands the width apart that makes you feel strong. Like find a placement for your hands in which you feel strong, connected, and engaged through your upper body. And then so then that's still me giving like an instruction and it's got like a general alignment there, but students can then within their own bodies fine tune and find the alignment that works best for them. And this is because the human body is variable, as we know. We're not all the same and our joints are not structured the same. Our ranges of motion are not the same. Like there's a lot of variability there. So while there is a bigger picture in which, you know, most human bodies can come into like a version, an approximate plank pose, but if we're really getting down into the fine-tuned details, there will be some natural variability there. Like some people might feel stronger with their hands slightly further apart. Some might feel stronger with their hands a little closer. Some might feel stronger with like the hands turned out a little, some maybe in a little. Like there are just all these ways that people can sense their own body to find what feels best for them in the moment. And then that can honor student individuality. And by posing, like teaching poses and using these more like inquisitive cues that ask students to like actually observe their own body and notice how they feel and then align accordingly, that can really help our students know their own body better. And that can be empowering, and empowering students and encouraging self-knowledge is to me like part of what a yoga practice is really all about. So that's just like one tiny example, but I do think that subtle awareness and subtle details can be very magical. And I really do try to use those often when I teach yoga. But again, it's just not in a controlling, like top-down manner. It's more in a way, or I try to make it, I try to offer it in a way that asks students to investigate their own bodies and their own poses. I have a couple examples to share of like what I might consider using subtle aspects of a yoga pose, like as a teaching tool, and how to illustrate that I do think that this is important and valuable. So one example might be, what if, for example, in a yoga class, I had a theme of like tuning us into our hips. So the hip joints, like maybe I wanted us to like feel this area like all the way around, front, sides, back, and then how the joint moves and our own individual hip joints, how they might differ side to side, just like all that kind of inquiry stuff into this area of the body. So if that were like my theme for my class that day, maybe I feel like we don't tend to think about the hips too much in plank pose, but maybe I would teach plank pose and ask students, like encourage them to, in this pose, can you feel down to your hips and notice what you feel there? And because I have an understanding of the biomechanics of plank pose, and you know, biomechanics and movement science is like a tool that I use to help me teach more intentionally, then I know that in plank pose, we are loading the hip flexor muscles that cross the front of the hip. There's work happening here. So I know that if I might offer some guidance for my students to kind of feel across the front of their hips and notice, do you feel work there? Like, what do you feel there? Maybe how does that work compare to what you feel in your anterior core? Like, is it different? You know, things like this, like using my knowledge of what's going on in the body biomechanically to guide students' awareness and what they're tuning into for them to then kind of learn about and feel their own body. So that might be kind of cool to be in plank and then notice what's actually happening when it comes to the hips. We tend to think about the upper body and maybe the abdominals in plank, but there is a hip element. We could bring our awareness there. And then maybe, again, if like the whole class theme was about the hips, Maybe we might do something like Purva Uttanasana, which is kind of a flipped plank pose. And then here, ask students, I might ask them to pay attention to their hips, the muscles like on the posterior hip here, because I understand the biomechanics of the pose. That's what's being loaded. What do they feel? What do they notice in that pose? And then what if we did something like forearm side plank? What do you feel and notice in your hip here? Like, is there work? Where is the work? I know that biomechanically the work is on the lateral hip of that bottom hip, but I can potentially guide students' awareness to that. So this is just one example. Like maybe the hip joint is a theme that I'm teaching, and then I can use that awareness, which I would suggest paying attention to your hip joint and then in all these different ways and all these different shapes, yoga poses, relation to gravity. That can be a really nice way to tune into some subtleness in our poses. So I said I had two examples. Here's my other example. Sometimes I have like a subtle theme in a class of tuning into something like 360 degree breathing in the rib cage. So we might start the class with the hands around the rib cage, and then we breathe intentionally so that we inhale and expand the fingers and exhale, the fingers draw back in, feeling our rib cage expand front to back, side to side, 360 degrees. So just a little skill, a little something to tune us into in the beginning. And I would argue that like your breath pattern and how your breath is moving your ribs is a pretty subtle detail. It's something that we can tune into in a subtle way. Then we could bring that skill and that awareness with us through the class. And in some other shapes, I might suggest or cue that we feel for our rib cage in that same area that we originally felt with our fingers back in the beginning. And what do you sense happening there? So like how is that 360 degree breathing different than say maybe we did like an opening seat in the very beginning and we breathed here. So you could like remember back to that, but now we're in a twist. And without bringing your fingers back to the rib cage, can you feel and sense like what's happening in your rib cage in that area as you inhale and exhale in this twisting position? And then maybe later on, we're in another pose where the spine is in a different position, reverse warrior, this one. Oh. Like reverse warrior, when we're in a side bend, lateral flexion, how does that 360 degree breathing show up here? And how is it different maybe side to side, like the stretching side versus the more compacted side? What about if we come into a pose like child's pose, which is an even different position for the spine, how do we sense that 360 degree breathing? And it's not that there's any right or wrong there, and it's not that it always has to be, we always have to breathe that way, but we could just use that tool as this point of focus to thread like all the way through a class, kind of link it together and just notice these different elements of the pose. Like here, when we're in flexion, we may find that we have like maybe more freedom or more ability to breathe posteriorly, maybe a little more than sides and front. I don't know, but maybe. So just things like that. To me, like breath awareness and like weaving it together throughout a class would be a way that I feel like I would use very detailed awareness to bring magic to yoga poses and to the overall practice. And the overall intention is inviting students to explore and feel their own bodies and just observe and notice. So hopefully this sort of makes sense. This is like how I would approach, teaching the details of a yoga pose, which is less about fine tuning and controlling all these, you know, checking all the alignment boxes that on this very fine tuned level, everybody, all bodies must embody. That's like more of a correct, incorrect approach or a controlling top down approach where the yoga instructor is controlling all elements of their yoga students' bodies. And for me, I'd prefer to, rather than control my students' bodies, I'd rather self-empower them to feel and learn about and move their own bodies. And although we are all operating within a bigger picture of these yoga poses, so I am controlling on that level as the teacher. I'm not gonna be so controlling on the fine-tune level. I think the fine-tune level is important and can be key for the magic of yoga, but not in a controlling, micromanaging way, more in an exploratory, inquisitive way. So I hope this helps answer that really good question. And if you have any questions or comments about this, let me know.